Well, that was some entrance, even for an Irish fighter. In
Ladies
Belfast.
And gentlemen,
here's Danny Small, RMC.
This is the principal contest of the evening, sponsored by Smirnoff. 12 3-minute rounds of boxing for the IBF Flyweight Championship of the World between Dave Boy McAuley and Baby Jake Matlala. At the weigh-in, Matlala weighed 7 stone 11 3/4 pounds. McAuley weighed 7 stone 13 pounds. Ladies and gentlemen, on my right, in the white corner, from Soweto, South Africa, Baby Jake Matlala. And on my left, in the blue corner, from Larne in Northern Ireland, the flyweight champion of the world, Dave Boy McAuley. Your judges appointed by the IBF, Mr. Don O'Neill of Massachusetts, USA, Mr. Roy Francis of Kent in England, Mr. Dave Parry of London, England. Your referee from Hackensack, New Jersey, Mr. Randy Newman. The IBF supervisor in charge is Robert W. Lee of New York. Officials appointed by the British Boxing Board of Control, the General Secretary of the British Boxing Board of Control, Mr. John Morris, in conjunction with the IBF. Stewards in charge, Mr. Bill Shearing, and inspectors, Dennis Carey and Mr. John Toner. Your medical officers, Dr. Paul McCune and George O'Neill. The timekeeper is Mr. Dale Elliott.
Strains of Danny Boy ringing out in this Maysfield Nurses Centre and providing, I suppose, as emotional an overture as you could wish for any championship fight. Well, if the fight lives up to the overture, it'll be some fight, and we've seen a few of those from Dave McAuley. He almost never has what you would ever call a dull fight. In fact, 9 times out of 10 he seems to have the most amazing wars with his opponent. Every single one of his defences so far has gone the full 12 rounds. Will this one tonight? Well, the little man who can decide that, the 4'9" Baby Jake Matlala, has been limbering up throughout all those preliminaries, keeping his legs supple and waiting for the moment when his big chance appears. Randy Newman, who's refereed one of McAuley's earlier fights, Randy Newman from the United States, ex-fighter. 12 rounds for the IBF, the International Boxing Federation flyweight title. And McAuley returns to this arena 4 months after his last defence. That points victory over another very small man, the Puerto Rican Pedro Feliciano. He was 5 feet tall. And this man, baby Jake, is 3 inches shorter than that. And in fact, McAuley is quite tall for a flyweight. He's 5'7 or so. McAuley is 10 inches tall. Matlala weighed in at only 7 stone 11¾. That's 2¼ pounds under the limit, 8 stone. But then he is, after all, the South African light flyweight champion, and not the flyweight champion, oddly enough. Light flyweight is 7 stone 10. Not, as far as I know, ever boxed outside the African continent before. It must be quite a culture shock, I would imagine, to come and find preliminaries the way they do them in Belfast. The record that McAuley is trying to beat tonight is the record set by the great Scot, Jim Watt, who made 4 successful consecutive defences of his World Lightweight Championship a few years ago, until he came up against Alexis Arguello of Nicaragua. There are claims that Jimmy Wild and Ted Kid Lewis many years ago actually set the record, but one or two of the defences that are claimed for those fighters were not universally recognised. Lala's problem, obviously, is to get in close and overcome the superior reach of the Irishman. And McAuley will be doing his level best throughout this fight to keep this at long range, because the South African does come here with a reputation of being a pretty solid body puncher when he gets inside. He's 29 years old, Matlala, and McAuley was 30 in June. Here we've got 2 experienced pros. Quiet opening. Well, a fairly modest 3 minutes to the start of this championship fight, with McAuley obviously pursuing the right tactics in trying to keep everything at long range. Dave Moy McAuley from Larne in County Antrim, not too far away from Belfast. There's the record. He's been a pro now since for many years now. This is his 8th World Championship fight, and he's only had 21 fights in all. So he's really not been overboxed over the years. And the only man who's ever beaten him, of course, those 2 defeats there, came from Fidel Bassa, the Colombian world champion, a few years ago. And this arena waiting for this fight to explode into action. Years. McAuley now has been a pro, and only those 21 fights. Previous successful defenses were against Dodi Penalosa from the Philippines, Louis Curtis from the United States, Rodolfo Blanco from Colombia, and he got a disputed decision there. A lot of people thought he hadn't won it. And 4 months ago, Pedro Feliciano of Puerto Rico. reports from South Africa tell us that Matlala has never been floored and never been cut. You couldn't say that of McAuley, who seems to pick up injuries in almost every fight he has, and has been on the floor by his own admission 16 times in his professional career. McAuley will find this strange. He's having to punch down at this very much shorter opponent. I doubt whether there are very many shorter professional fighters anywhere in the world. There might be one or two in the Far East. Many who box at what they call straw weight, which is the lightest weight of all, 7.5 stars. Matlala working all the time to try to get inside where he can do some damage. And McAuley using every inch of this very big ring. It's a full, I think it's absolutely a full-size ring. So there's plenty of room for him to move about. Lala picking up those punches on the top of his bald head. Beginning to get some quick punches through to the head. He's used to fighting opponents taller than himself. He says he's never ever met or fought anybody shorter than he is. Two rounds completed. And, well, the little man probably a bit behind. When you come challenging for a title, you've really got to come and take the points. It's you can't just box defensively or negatively. And for the most part, McAuley has dictated the exchanges. And here are the statistics for this little man, 4'9.5". But look at the number of fights he's had compared with McAuley, 42 fights. And that's precisely double the number that McAuley has had. 8 defeats. He's been in several South African championship battles. He's been stopped only once, he says, when he retired himself at the end of 11 rounds in a South African title fight. Well, so far, this fight has not had the explosive quality that we've seen in some of McAuley's championship battles. The first one with Fidel Bassa was one of the most extraordinary fights I've ever seen. When McAuley was on the verge of being knocked out in the first round, then came close to defeating Bassa in the middle of the fight, and finally gave up with exhaustion after 13 rounds. Of course, those were the days of 15-round battles. Now we're down to 12. Heads inside there. Randy Newman, the ex-fighter, towering over these two little men. Matlala working all the time to try to get in close. He loves to be in close and punch to the body, you're told. Matlala's been around as a pro a very long time, since 1980, as a matter of fact. And at that time, McAuley was still an amateur. In fact, in 1980, he was Ulster and Irish amateur flyweight champion and still 3 years away from turning pro. McAuley playing this very, very cautiously indeed. I think sensing a long fight. And also just trying to feel what this little man has in store for him. McAuley trying now to get the 1-2 going. The left followed by the right. Quite happy to stand in and trade punches. And McAuley has not yet caught him with a solid right hand. That last victory of McAuley's, the fourth successful defense. He actually was down in that one as well in the sixth round, but in the end he won a massive points victory on all the three judges cards. McAuley won this IBF title at Wembley in June 89 from Duke McKenzie, and incidentally congratulations to Duke on recently winning the WBO bantamweight title. There are now four major governing bodies in world boxing and they all have their own world titles. So McAuley is one of four world flyweight titles, title holders. And the little South African still hoisting up his shorts and a little slow to get out there. Both married men. McAuley used to work as a chef in the family restaurant in Larne, but the business has been sold, and he's more concerned these days with looking after his new home and getting it in the right shape. McAuley just needs perhaps to step the pace up a little bit and to be slightly more aggressive. He's beginning to allow the South African to come to him and dictate it. Matlala. I think the little man felt it. He certainly felt that one. And those quick punches are beginning to find their way through the defences. But he doesn't want to expose himself too much, McAuley, to this sort of thing. Successful defenses behind him. He's now far and away, of course, the most successful Irish professional fighter of all time. McAuley trying to find a way underneath with hooks to the body. And all he sees for the most part is the top of that bald head coming at him.
Going
Well, so far we've seen the third now of the scheduled fight, and there's been no significant sway either way here in fortunes. It's very much open and difficult really at this point to predict how this might go. But quite clearly this little man knows what he's doing. He's been around a long time. Although he's not accustomed to traveling abroad and fighting, he clearly knows his way around a boxing ring. Here's a little bit of action from that previous round with McAuley's trying to stab these punches out with some success occasionally, but all the time this little man coming back at him two-fisted, working his way inside with a lot of skill and guile. Claims to have won his last eight fights. Matlala. McAuley is boxing tonight as though he's absolutely determined not to have one of his famous wars. Maybe worried about facial injuries. And he's, so far, boxing is very, very coolly indeed. It's a little bit reminiscent of the defense he had against Louis Curtis of the United States, which was a quiet fight, but overwhelmingly won, of course, by McAuley. McAuley's a shade ahead now, but the rounds are all close. McAuley came in just a pound under the 8-stone limit. He's done very well all these years to maintain himself, for a tall flyweight, to maintain himself able to make 8-stone. That is not easy. But this man has managed it, and from some of the fights he's had, he's clearly managed to stay strong at the weight because he's come back from the most extraordinary situations. Man from Soweto, still trying to get inside, but being kept at bay here by these quick stabbing punches from McAuley. Here he comes again. McAuley is elusive enough to keep out of the way of him. And those are quite a good exchanges from McAuley's point of view. The Matlala punches are doing nothing. They're landing on his gloves. But McAuley is finding him with good punches, and that right hand was the best punch that McAuley has thrown so far. Fifth round, and it clearly hurt the South African. That was the first really hard right hand to nail Matlala. This work from the South African, really not getting him very far. McAuley handling himself well, keeping out of trouble, and he eyed Matlala very closely there as they parted on their way back to the corners, just to have a look at what he might have done to him with that right hand, because that punch in that round was the most significant one thrown so far. And it was a typical McAuley blow. He's been working for that for a long time. I said earlier he was trying to get the 1-2 going, and he certainly managed it here. We can see it again here. That was it. Bomp, bomp. And from that moment, the supporters of McAuley were on their feet cheering him, cheering for him to go and get him. So that will have given that corner a lot of confidence. they come to round six of this Smirnoff-sponsored fight for the International Boxing Federation flyweight title. There are three other, as I was saying earlier, world flyweight champions about. The WBA, that's the World Boxing Association champion, is Yong Kang Kim of South Korea. The WBC World Boxing Council champion is Muang Chai Kittikasam from Thailand. And the World Boxing Organization champion, the WBO champion, is Isidro Perez from Mexico. It's a shame that world championships are fragmented in this way these days. It's so much better, I think, for a sport if it's got an undisputed champion. It's sad for someone like McAuley, knowing that there are three other guys who are also claiming to be the champion. Good right hand again from McAuley. It's beginning to look as though these short punches to the head are beginning to slow the man from Soweto, Baby Jake. He's looking a little more labored, and I'm not surprised as he's walking in now. His face is wide open now to these quick 1-2 punches from McAuley. Both men well drenched in water, and a lot of it comes flying out through the ropes when they come this way. And Matlala has found some more energy from somewhere and putting in quite a determined effort in this round once he gets McAuley to the ropes. But he's taking deep breaths now when he draws away. McAuley taking one or two punches to the head here. But from what we've seen so far, the South African doesn't look to me like a really damaging puncher. It's the sort of remark that brings disaster on, of course. So now we're halfway through this World Flyweight Championship. Six more rounds to go. And I wonder if Matlala's wondering himself quite what he has to do here to make an impression on the champion. Because so far, he hasn't really ever, I wouldn't think, troubled McAuley too much. And just while they're being refreshed, we spare a thought for one of Britain's top referees, Roland Dakin, who is none too well at the moment and in hospital in Reading. And we send him, we hope he's watching. And if he is, we send him our best wishes for a speedy recovery. Second half of this championship with McAuley ahead almost certainly, but the issue far from settled. McAuley very conscious, of course, that he can make British boxing history here tonight by winning this and put up those, get those five consecutive title defenses behind him. And he certainly is playing it cautiously. punches, jolted McAuley's head back. His most dangerous moments are when he retreats to the ropes, which is exactly where Matlala wants him. Again, he's back to the ropes, trying to nail Matlala with one of those right hands again. But at the moment, McCoy hasn't quite really stamped authority on this. He's still allowing the little man to work him over a bit. Better quality about McCauley's punches when he gets them through. A lot of works hard, he throws all the leather, but a great deal of it is wasted, and a lot more of it is a little slappy. And there were one or two punches in that final exchange that got through to Matlala. And although I think Paul is ahead, I must repeat, I don't think he's really stamped a world champion's authority on this as yet. But there's still plenty of time left. 30 in June, McAuley. No previous fighter from Ireland has ever had as many world title fights. His eighth world championship tonight in 4 years, including those two colossal battles for the WBA flyweight championship with Fidel Vassar in 87. And 88, and Vassar is still the only professional fighter to have beaten him. And of course, all this has come after quite a distinguished amateur career, but that was all 9-10 years ago. Mr. Robert Lee, the IBF executive. Judges sitting ringside here tonight, and it'll be the three judges who decide this if it goes all the way. The referee takes no part in the scoring. Two of those judges come from Britain. They're both top-class referees in Britain, Roy Francis and Dave Paris, and both ex-fighters. No knockdowns, no cuts. So far. This is the second round in a row that McCauley has allowed Matlala to swarm all over him on the ropes. Interesting to know. I'd like to know just how the judges are seeing this fight. I think it could be very close. But these are better punches now from McCauley. When he gets off the ropes and works out towards the centre of the ring, he does much better. For the most part, McCauley has relied on counter-punching in this contest. Yeah. time and time again, McAuley has wound up in that spot over there, right by his own corner. He's back to the ropes. Probably listening to craft a bit of advice from the corner. McAuley, well aware of what he's doing there, although the other man's coming at him. McAuley's eyes were on the man all the time and looking for every chance to put the punches in and to place them correctly. Again, Matlala blows heavily as he comes away. McAuley's best work coming in short, sharp bursts. So now two-thirds of this fight completed. He takes a deep, deep breath, this 29-year-old South African who is a well-educated man. He has a diploma in accountancy, and he's studying business economics at this very time. He says the hardest fight he ever had was against a Mexican, Martin Cardenas. He won that on points in Port Elizabeth in 1989. He's the current holder of the South African light flyweight title, and he's held that title twice, having lost it at one point and then regained it. But he's never held the South African flyweight title, the 8-stone title. And of course, it's a flyweight championship he's after here tonight. So, all ready for round 9.
Second side, right back.
Randy Newman, the massive American referee, has had very little to do in this fight. Hardly been seen. Explosive action, but he's still playing it quite cautiously. The attacks are only coming in limited bursts, and he's constantly getting himself on the ropes and allowing the little man to swarm against him. And that's aggression from Matlala, and it could be earning him points. Ninth round, action hotting up a little, but one has to say it's been a fairly quiet fight all the way through so far. And although McAuley is allowing the man to come to him, you couldn't really say that Matlala has done enough so far to put himself into a winning position. He's got to do a lot of work to take the world champion's fight away, title away rather, and I don't think Matlala's done that sort of work. However, that's all down to the judges if he goes the distance. Mm-hmm. one back as the bell goes. And Harry's back to Bernardo Checo and Barney Eastwood in the corner. I think if I were in that corner attending McAuley, I'd be inclined to say to him right now, come on, we want three very positive final rounds now. You don't need to save too much energy now. We're in the last stages. And you can afford to spend some of it. And I think he really needs three positive rounds now. Get some action from that last round. McAuley pumping away here, trying to find a way through that covered defence. The little man, 4'9" South African, is quite capable at taking care of himself. So three rounds to go. And McAuley perhaps on the verge of making some British boxing history. McAuley, the IBF champion, in this fifth defence of his title against the man from Soweto, 29-year-old baby Jacob Matlala. It's nice to see South Africa gradually being drawn back into the sporting fold after years of isolation. Ryan Mitchell has been their most successful recent fighter, world champion. And of course, South African boxing history goes back a long way, and they've had great fighters in the past, white fighters for the most part in the past. Going back to the days pre-war of Ben Ford, the South African heavyweight. It's a good attack by McAuley. He always works better when he's off the ropes. Still looking for the counter punches, allowing the other man to lead first. McAuley well covered up. Puts in another of those sharp punches. Only once has he really looked like doing serious damage to Matlala, and that was several rounds ago with the right hand. Round 10. He found the punch at last. Randy Newman looking right into his eyes. I don't think he's going to beat the count. He hasn't. He didn't beat the count. And in the 10th round, Dave Boy McAuley knocks his man out with one extraordinary punch. This man has some really amazing battles. And there it was, quiet for round after round after round. And then suddenly, the explosive end. And Dave Boy McAuley has made his fifth successful consecutive defence, and he makes British boxing history. And Tony Baker, one of his assistants, leading him round and signalling to the crowd, come on, support your man, he's done it again. McAuley is still the champion. Well, I don't know what Barney Eastwood was saying to McAuley. It looks as though he's pretty excited
Ladies
about what's happened,
and
I'm not surprised.
Two minutes, 23 seconds into round 10. The referee stopped the contest on a countdown, and the winner and still flyweight champion of the world is Dave Boy McAuley.
And Belfast rises to greet its champion. So McAuley has done it again. And from out of the the quiet of a very ordinary fight, one has to say. From out of the quiet, suddenly came the explosion, and it was over. Well, we may well see that finish again once we get McAuley up for interview.
Ladies
I expect we'll be showing him it.
Is now being presented once again to Dave Boy McAuley by Robert W. Lee, supervisor of the IBF. And tonight
and
you have witnessed
World
history in the north of Ireland because Dave Boy McAuley has made it.
So the little bit of history is duly recorded by the MC, and Jim Watt's record of 4 successful consecutive defences has gone by the board, and McAuley will now presumably go for number 6. And I think McAuley's coming over to meet our man up there, Jim Neely.
David McAuley, history maker, you've always given us great value for money, but have you ever produced in your life a finish like that?
No, that guy was very strong, and as you know, the IBF title is the most prestigious out of the three, and everybody wants it very badly, and there's no way they get mine. They have to move up the bantamweight, super bantamweight or whatever, but the flyweight title stays in Ireland.
The physical difference between you in terms of height, how much of a problem was that for you?
There was a physical difference in height, but there was only two pound of difference in weight, which meant he was punching a full 8 stone as I was punching a full 8 stone. The height difference maybe looked an advantage, but he was as strong as a bull. There's no doubt about that. He was very, very, very strong. He took some good left, took some cracking body shots, and that right hand at the end just finished him. But he was strong. I have to give him credit.
You still have this sort of heart-stopping effect in all of us, occasionally staying in the ropes and everybody shouting at you, get off the ropes, get off the ropes.
I can fight in the ropes, I can box, I can do whatever suits me because I'm good in the ropes, I'm good in the middle of the ring. I do whatever I have to do, I adjust.
There's the finish, David.
Just a great right hand. He just walked right onto it and there's nothing he could do to avoid it. It just came and bang, down he went.
The overhead camera, talk us through it.
It was a crack, I just hit him right on the button. I seen him coming in. He was dropping his left guard slightly, so I made him pay. The same way as people make me pay. On other occasions, I made him pay.
Well, David, has the reality of the boxing history that you've actually made set in yet?
No, because I didn't go out to make history. I went out to defend my world title successfully. And and I think it's great to be matched up alongside the likes of the great Jim Watt. And I only hope I can do the record he had justice and honour it and defend it as well as what he did.
David, 30 years young and still going to keep going, I hope.
Well, it's looking like it. I'm not ready to retire yet.
Far from it.
Too much to do yet.
David, well done. Thanks for another smashing night in Belfast.
Thank
well done.
Thank you very much, Jeff.